They know our position. The world knows our position, I clarified it at the United Nations
but
over the past.
If it would, do you think they would drop a bomb or launch a missile on Israel?
Wolf, my judgment is you got to take everybody's word seriously in this world. You can't, again, you can't just hope for the best. You got to assume that the leader, when he says that he would like to destroy Israel, means what he says. If you take, if you say, well, gosh, maybe he doesn't mean it, and you turn out to be wrong, you have not done your duty as a world leader. Absolutely, I take him seriously. Just like I take Al Qaeda seriously when they say they're going to attack us again.
George Voinovich, the Republican senator from Ohio, has compared him to Hitler.
Yeah, people have got strong opinions about him, and I can understand why. Iran wants to stop the advance of democracy and peace. And I can understand why people have strong opinions about the Iranian regime. First, if I were the Israeli foreign minister, I'd be deeply concerned about somebody in my neighborhood whose stated objective was the destruction of my country. I'm concerned that Iran is trying to stall. The country can face isolation. They could face sanctions. Or they can choose a better course. The choice is the Iranian leader's choice.
Is there anything you heard from him in his address last night or your analysts that was encouraging?
Not really.
We see these horrible bodies showing up, tortured,
yeah.
Mutilation, the Shia and the Sunni, the Iranians apparently having a negative role. Of course, the Al-Qaeda in Iraq still operating.
You see it on TV, and that's the power of an enemy that is willing to kill innocent people. 12 million people voted last December. Admittedly, it seems like a decade ago. I like to tell people when the final history is written on Iraq, it'll look like just a comma. I'm impressed by President Maliki. I've talked to him. I've seen the decision-making process that he's put in place. The Iraqi army is still recruiting and training.
You weren't upset when he went to Tehran, gave a big hug and a kiss to Ahmadinejad?
Excuse me for a minute. I was on a brilliant point, as you know. The Iraqi government and the Iraqi military.
I woke up in New York like you did this morning. I read.
What are you reading?
The New York Times. There's a paragraph in here. I'll read it to you.
Well,
about your dad's former Secretary of State, James Baker. In his 1995 memoir, Mr. Baker said he opposed ousting Saddam Hussein in the Persian Gulf War in 1991 because he feared that such action might lead to an Iraqi civil war, to criticism from many of our allies, and to an eventual loss of American support for an occupation.
Yeah. He was writing before September the 11th, 2001. And the world changed that day, Wolf.
But Iraq had nothing to do with 9/11.
Excuse me for a minute, please. The world changed that day because we had to deal with threats. No question, Saddam Hussein did not order the attacks. On the other hand, Saddam Hussein was viewed as a threat by the Congress, by the United Nations, and by the United States administration. And so James Baker was writing before the world changed.
You know, you were thinking of dealing with Saddam Hussein long before 9/11.
Well, I wasn't in office long before 9/11.
Well, I wasn't
in office that much longer.
I'm going to remind you of an interview you and I did.
It was 9/11, 2001, and I swore in January 2001.
When you were a candidate for president, you were still the governor of Texas, you and I sat down in Iowa just before the Iowa caucus, and we had this exchange. Listen. This is what you said. We shouldn't be sending mixed signals to Saddam Hussein. And if at any time I found that the Iraqis were developing weapons of mass destruction, they wouldn't exist anymore. Blitzer. Who wouldn't exist? The weapons? Bush. The weapons of mass destruction, yes. I'm not going to. They just need to hear that from a potential president, that if we catch them in violation of the agreement, if we in any way, shape, or form find out that they're developing weapons of mass destruction, that there will be action taken, and they can just guess what that action might be. Do you remember that exchange?
No, but I'm sure I said it.
You did say it. We have it on tape, obviously.
Therefore, I'm really sure I said it. I strongly stand by my decision to remove Saddam Hussein.
And you don't look back with any regrets?
I regret when people lose lives. But, and presidents don't get to do do-overs. I strongly stand by my decision to remove Saddam Hussein.
And you don't look back with any regrets.
I regret when people lose lives. But, you know, and presidents don't get to do do-overs.
The Pope, he's got some controversy right now over what he said about Islam. Did he do the right thing? What do you think of this uproar?
I was appreciative of the fact that he tried to clarify what he meant. This is a struggle not between religions, and that's what people have got to understand. It's a struggle between people who use religion to kill and those of us who are for peace. And to the extent that that issue gets muddied up, it confuses people. And so the clarity helps people get back to the real issue we face. People say this is a struggle of civilizations. I strongly disagree with that. I think this is a struggle for civilization. And to the extent that the Pope clarified the issue, I think it helps those of us who are trying to make it clear to the Muslim world in particular, we're not fighting Islam.
Is it a mistake to use that phrase, Islamic fascists?
That's what I'm referring to. I'm referring to extremists and radicals, totalitarians. The point I was making is these people share a common ideology that represses women, doesn't give people the right to dissent, that has got their narrow view of the freedom of religion. I don't believe these people represent the true spirit of Islam.
Mr. President, thanks very much.
Yes, sir. I strongly stand by my decision to remove Saddam Hussein.
And you don't look back with any regrets?
I regret when people lose lives. But, and presidents don't get to do do-overs.